Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar AS Academy. The display news articles along with the page numbers are provided here for your reference. The PDF link of the handwritten notes along with the time stamping of the news analysis is provided in the description box as well as in the comment section for smart mobile users. Now let us start our news analysis. This news article is about the bill that has been introduced in the Lok Sabha regarding the merger of two Union Territories. The syllabus relevant to the analysis of this news article is highlighted here for your reference. See, the central government has decided to merge the two Union Territories, which are the Union Territory of Dadra and Nagar Haveli and the Union Territory of Daman and Diu. So, in this context, a bill has been introduced in the Lok Sabha by the Union Minister of State of the Ministry of Home Affairs, and the bill is called as the Dadra and Nagar Haveli and Daman and Diu Merger of Union Territories Bill of 2019. So, in this context, let us see about these Union Territories in terms of geographical perspective, then brief historical perspective as well as important political aspects of these Union Territories. Now, look at this map. From this map, we can say that the Union Territory of Dadra Nagar Haveli is located on the western side of the foothills of Western Ghats. Then Silvassa is the capital of this Union Territory. Kindly notice that the Union Territory of Dadra Nagar Haveli shares border with the states of Gujarat and Maharashtra. The important aspect of this Union Territory is that about 40% of the total geographical area is covered with forest, and also the tribal population is very high in this Union Territory. That is, around 60% of the entire population is tribal population. Note that the major river, that is Daman Ganga, passes through this Union Territory and finally drains into Arabian Sea at Daman. Now let us see about Daman and Diu. If you look at geographical location of this Daman and Diu Union Territory, these are two separate locations which are almost 700 kilometers apart from each other. And Daman is on mainland near southern portion of Gujarat state. As we have already mentioned that Daman Ganga river drains into Arabian Sea at Daman, and Daman is the headquarters of Daman and Diu Union Territory. Now look at the location of Diu, which is an island near Junagadh district of Gujarat state. These are the some of the important geographical aspects of these two Union Territories. Now let us see about the history of these Union Territories in brief. Know that these Union Territories were under the Portuguese rule for a longer period. From 1961 to 1987, the Daman and Diu were part of the Union Territory of Goa. Then, when the Goa got statehood in 1987, Daman and Diu were made as a separate Union Territory. As we have discussed that this Union Territory, that is Dadra Nagar Haveli, was under the rule of Portuguese. And know that it was occupied by the Portuguese in 1783, and since then it was under the rule of Portuguese. It was only in 1954 that the residents of Dadra Nagar Haveli got liberated from the Portuguese rule. After that, that is from 1954 to 1961, the territory was administered by a citizens council called the Varishtha Panchayat of Free Dadra and Nagar Haveli. After that, that is in 1961, it was merged with the Republic of India and made as a separate Union Territory. Now, we'll discuss in brief about polity aspects of these Union Territories. Kindly notice that the provisions regarding the administration of Union Territories are mentioned in the Part 8 of the Indian Constitution. If you see the administration of the Union Territories, generally these Union Territories are administered by the President through an administrator appointed by him as per Article 239, Clause 1 of the Indian Constitution. So for your information, know that the administrators of Andaman Nicobar Islands, then Delhi, then Puducherry were designated as lieutenant governors. And the governor of Punjab is currently holding the responsibility of administrator of Chandigarh. But in case of Dadra Nagar Haveli, the administrator of this union territory is concurrently the administrator of Daman and Diu. So we can see that there is a common administrator for both these union territories. Also notice that there is no legislature in both these union territories. In addition, if you see in terms of administration, many departments have a common administration, but only the secretariats of these departments, that is the offices, are separate. So having two separate constitutional and administrative entities in these union territories lead to lot of duplicacy, then inefficiency, and also wasteful expenditure. If you notice the present government policy, minimum government and maximum governance, so considering small population and limited geographical area of both these union territories, and to use the services of officers efficiently, now the central government has decided to merge these union territories into a single union territory. Therefore, in this direction, a bill was introduced in the Lok Sabha known as the Union Territories of Dadra Nagar Haveli and Daman and Diu, Merger of Union Territories Bill of 2019. At present, India has 28 states and 9 union territories, and if both Daman and Diu and Dadra Nagar Haveli are merged, then India will have 28 states and 8 union territories in the future. Therefore, we shall see more about the future course of this bill in our coming analysis sessions. With this information, we have come to the end of the analysis of this news article. Have a look at the practice question, which will be discussed at the end of the session. Now, let us proceed to the next news article analysis. This news article speaks about the launch of CartoSat 3 satellite. Know that today morning, the PSLV C-47 has successfully launched the CartoSat 3 satellite and 13 other satellites of US customers into their respective orbits. And these satellites were launched from the Satish Dhawan Space Center, that is SHOT, at Sriharikota in the coastal district of Andhra Pradesh. The syllabus relevant to the analysis of this news article is highlighted here for your reference. Now let us discuss in brief about CartoSat 3 satellite. It is the most advanced Earth observation satellite of Indian Space Research Organization, and it is considered as a third generation advanced agile satellite. Here, agile or agility is the ability of the satellite to move quickly and easily. The significant feature of this CartoSat 3 is that it will obtain panchromatic and multispectral imagery. Here, panchromatic means it is sensitive to or captures all visible colors of light. Then multispectral means it can operate in several regions of the electromagnetic spectrum. Know that this CartoSat 3 satellite is an Earth observation satellite with an operation life of about 5 years. The Earth observation satellites usually support many applications in the areas of land and water resources management, then in the field of cartography, then in the studies of oceanic and atmospheric studies. Apart from these applications, the CartoSat satellite series mainly focus on cartography, which is the science or practice of drawing maps. The significant aspect of this CartoSat 3 satellite is that it offers the best ever resolution, that is about 25 centimeters in the whole series of CartoSat satellites. It means that from a height of around 500 kilometers, these satellite, that is CartoSat 3 satellite, can distinguish an object with a minimum size of 25 centimeters in length. This resolution, that is of 25 centimeters, assumed significance because the previous best of the CartoSat series was about 65 centimeters. as per the news article, the current best resolution in the world is about 31 centimeters. That is provided by the World View 3 satellite, which is owned by a US company. This is why the news article says that the CartoSat 3 satellite will have the sharpest eye of civilian remote sensing satellites in the world. Kindly note that the Indian Space Research Organization has launched 8 CartoSats since 2005, and these satellites are namely, and these satellites are CartoSat 1, then CartoSat 2, then CartoSats 2A to 2F, and these satellites constitutes constellation of 8 CartoSats since the launch of first satellite in 2005. Now, after the success of the launch of CartoSat 3 satellite, it has become 9th and the most advanced in the series of CartoSat satellites. And this satellite, that is CartoSat 3 satellite, has many new technologies such as a highly agile or flexible camera, then high-speed data transmission, then advanced computer system and new power electronics. As per the ISRO data, this CartoSat 3 satellite will provide the best quality images of the Earth. But on the other hand, these best quality images of Earth will not be available for all of us. We need to understand or discuss some provisions of remote sensing data policy of 2011, which was adopted by the Government of India. And as per the policy, it deals with the modalities or procedures for managing or permitting the acquisition and the dissemination of remote sensing data for the needs of socio-economic activities. The policy clearly prescribes that all remote sensing data of resolution up to 1 meter shall be distributed on a non-discriminatory basis and on a requested basis. This is mainly on the grounds of protecting the national security, because if data of better than 1 meter resolution is accessed by everyone, and this data can be misused. Therefore, the resolution below 1 meter shall be screened or can be accessed with the prior permission of the appropriate agencies. It means that only the government and the government authorized agencies shall have access to ISRO's high resolution images below a resolution of 1 meter. And other private and foreign users require prior permission to use such data with a resolution that is less than 1 meter. These are some of the important aspects with respect to CartoSat 3 satellite. With this, we have come to the end of the discussion of this topic. The displayed practice question will be discussed at the end of the session. Now let us proceed to the next news article analysis. This news article is regarding the concerns raised by the Deputy Governor of Reserve Bank of India on the rising bad loans from Pradhan Mantri Mudra Yojana. So in this context, we'll see about the details of Mudra Yojana and its various components like Sishu, Kishore and Tarun aspects of the Mudra Yojana, and also the concerns raised by the Deputy Governor. The syllabus relevant to this news article is highlighted here for your reference. The Mudra Yojana, that is Pradhan Mantri Mudra Yojana, is one of the important program of the Government of India to fund the non-corporate, non-firm, small or micro enterprises. And this Yojana was launched in 2015. See, the micro enterprises in India, despite their huge growth and employment generation potential, has been facing the challenges of getting formal credit. Therefore, Mudra Yojana tries to fund the unfunded by bringing such enterprises under the formal financial system and extending affordable credit to such micro enterprises. Here, Mudra stands for Micro Units Development and Refinancing Agency. And the implementing agency of Pradhan Mantri Mudra Yojana is Mudra Agency Limited. And it was set up as a financial institution by the Government of India for development and refinancing of micro units enterprises. Know that the purpose of Mudra is to provide funding to the non-corporate small business sector through refinancing mechanism. Here, refinancing mechanism involves two stages. In the first stage, the commercial banks, regional rural banks, cooperative banks, microfinance institutions, and non-banking finance institutions or non-banking finance companies were actually involves or extends the credit to micro enterprises, and the given fund or the given credit would be refinanced by Mudra Agency Limited. As per the Mudra Yojana, the target group is the non-corporate small business segment, and this segment mostly consists of small manufacturing units, service sector units, shopkeepers, vegetable vendors, and also food service units, mission operators, small industries, artisans, etc., and whose credit need is mostly less than about 10 lakh rupees. And this Mudra Yojana is expected to boost the entrepreneurship and would enable employment generation and productivity of this sector. And the loans given to these small business segments comes under mainly three categories, namely Shishu category, Kishore category, then Tarun category. These categories signify the funding needs of the beneficiary micro unit or their stage of growth, and also provide a reference point for the next phase of the future growth. The financial limit of these categories are, that is, in case of Shishu category, the loan is up to 50,000 rupees, and in case of Kishore category, the loans can be given up to 5 lakh rupees, and then in Tarun category, the loan amount is above 5 lakh rupees but up to 10 lakh rupees. And the beneficiaries as per this Yojana can get these loans from commercial banks, regional rural banks, also from cooperative banks, microfinance institutions, and including non-banking finance companies. The significant aspect of this Mudra Yojana is that the borrowers will be provided with a debit called the Mudra card, and this card can be operated across the country for withdrawal of cash from any ATM and can also make payment through any point of sale machines. As per the news article, the scheme has lifted many beneficiaries out of the poverty, because the scheme is expected to boost the entrepreneurship and to generate employment and also to increase the productivity of micro enterprises sector. But the article mentions that in case of Mudra Yojana, the levels of non-performing assets among the borrowers is also increasing. And as per the news article, the total non-performing assets in the Mudra scheme has increased from about 2.52% in the financial year 18 to 2.68% during the financial year 2018-19. The article also mentions a disturbing fact about the rising non-performing assets, and it says that the bad loans in the scheme raised by 126% during the financial year 19, and it is a jump from about 9,200 crores in the financial year 18 to about 16,480 crores during the financial year 2018-2019. So it indicates that if you compare the financial years 18 and financial year 19, in terms of total non-performing assets, it has almost doubled from about 9,000 crores to about 16,000 crores. Therefore, in this context, the Reserve Bank of India would ask bankers to closely monitor the loans provided and also the future loans to ensure that the loans are not defaulted. It is because an unsustainable credit growth or rising non-performing assets can make the entire system unstable. The article also mentions that micro, small, medium enterprises in the near future will get loans easily, as lending will shift from collateral based lending to cash flow based lending. Here, collateral based lending means generally the creditors or a financial institution lends money based on the borrower's assets,
or borrower's surety, like they have to mortgage their property or machinery, etc. But in case of cash flow based lending, the lenders give loans by using the expected cash flow that a borrower company or a borrowing company generates as collateral for the loan. It means that the loan is provided based on the expected revenue generated by the borrower in the near future. Hence, there is no need for providing collaterals for the financial institutions. Therefore, with respect to this news article, we have discussed the important aspects of Pradhan Mantri Mudra Yojana and its various components like Shishu, Kishore and Tarun categories of loans, and also the concerns raised by the Deputy Governor of RBI. Have a look at the practice question. This question will be discussed at the end of the session. Now, let us proceed to the next news article analysis. This news article is about the observations made by the United Nations Environment Program in its Emissions Gap Report. And this gap report discusses on countries' action to combat global warming. So, in this context, we'll be discussing about the common terminologies like what is meant by global warming and the greenhouse gases and the examples for the greenhouse gases and various conventions like United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change and other protocols like Kyoto Protocol, including various conferences, including various important conference of parties. Finally, we'll be discussing about highlights of Emissions Gap Report, which is released by UNEP. The syllabus relevant to the analysis of this news article is given here for your reference. Now, we'll start with definition of global warming, which is an average increase in the temperature of the atmosphere and which can contribute to the changes in the global climate patterns. The global warming can either be because of natural causes or human-induced causes. If you see global warming, which means that warming that can occur as a result of increased emissions of greenhouse gases from various socio-economic activities. So, in this context, let us see what are greenhouse gases and what is meant by greenhouse effect. Here, the greenhouse gases refer to those gases of the atmosphere that can absorb and can re-emit the infrared radiation. These gases can either be present naturally in the atmosphere or it can present due to anthropogenic activities, and that is because of man-made activities. Now, look at this picture, and this picture explains the greenhouse effect much better, and it shows that how the greenhouse gases absorb the infrared radiation from the sun and how these gases which are present in the atmosphere re-emit this infrared radiation in all the directions, which causes the warming of the Earth's surface, including the atmosphere of the Earth. And this is what we call it as a global warming. And because of this, the global climate patterns are disturbed. For example, in the case of Indian monsoon, which is also affected by the impact of climate change as a result of global warming. In case of Indian monsoon, as a consequence of the climate change, one can notice the delayed onset of Indian monsoon and also irregular movement of Indian monsoon. And these are some of the consequences of global warming. Now, we'll see the examples for greenhouse gases, which includes water vapor, carbon dioxide, methane, nitrous oxide, then fluorinated gases like hydrofluorocarbons, perfluorocarbons, sulfur hexafluoride, including black carbon and brown carbon. And these examples as greenhouse gases are very important for your prelims examination. Kindly notice that there are important international conventions and protocols like Kyoto Protocol, and then agreements and important panels to address various aspects of global warming and its consequences. Here, one such convention is the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change. It was adopted by the countries in 1992 and it came into enforcement in 1994. This UNFCCC is popularly known as Rio Convention because it is one of the three conventions which are adapted at the Rio Earth Summit in 1992. And the other conventions include UN Convention on Biological Diversity and the Convention to Combat Desertification. As per the UNFCCC, the aim of this convention is to prevent the dangerous human interference with the climate system. Know that almost about 197 countries that have ratified the convention are called as parties to the convention. Now, let us see some of the important protocols that were signed in different conference of parties. The main protocol is that one of the main protocol is the Kyoto Protocol, which was adapted in 1997, but it entered into force only in the year 2005. This Kyoto Protocol is the one which operationalizes this UNFCCC. The next important agreement that you should know is about the Paris Agreement, which was signed by the parties to the convention in COP21 meeting, and this COP21 was held in Paris. The important outcome of this Paris Agreement is to strengthen the global response to the threat of climate change. And the plan is to keep the rising global temperature below 2 degrees Celsius with reference to pre-industrial levels by the end of this century, and to continue efforts to limit the temperature increase even further to 1.5 degrees Celsius. And this agreement also requires all the parties which are member to this convention to put forward their best efforts to address climate change through nationally determined contributions. So each country will come up with their own targets that will help in addressing the impact of climate change. As we have already mentioned that this conference of parties is held every year, and the 25th conference of parties, or COP25, used to be held at Madrid, which is the capital city of Spain, in the coming month of December. So we can expect many news articles on climate change in the coming days. And today's article is also one of such news article. Whatever we have discussed, that is what is meant by global warming and the impact of global warming, including climate change and the important conventions in the domain of climate change, which is UNFCCC. These details we have mentioned to understand specific protocols related to UNFCCC in detail in our future sessions. Now, let us see the news article. Now, look at this news article in the context of coming COP25. And the article has mentioned that the United Nations Environment Program, in short UNEP, has warned the countries that the actions taken by these countries are inadequate to combat global warming. See, every year the UNEP assesses the gap between anticipated emissions in the year 2030 and the current emissions levels of the parties of the agreement, that is Paris Agreement. And based on this gap, it prepares a report which is known as Emissions Gap Report. And this year also UNEP has released the 10th Emissions Gap Report. As per the UNEP, the emissions gap could also be called the commitment gap because it measures the gap between what we need to do and what we are actually doing to tackle the impact of climate change. This year emissions gap report projects three important trend lines, and the first one is that about the amount of greenhouse gas emissions that are released every year up to the year of 2030. And the next trend line is that the commitments that the countries are making to reduce their emissions and the impact of these commitments which are likely to have on overall emissions reduction. And finally, about the pace at which these emissions must be reduced to reach an emissions low that would limit temperature increase to about 1.5 degrees Celsius. Now, let us see the outcomes of the report that is mentioned in this news article. In this report, UNEP has told that countries must cut their greenhouse gas emissions by at least threefold so that there is a chance to contain or curtail the severe effects of global warming. The UNEP has also mentioned that unless global greenhouse gas emissions fall by about 7.6% each year between 2020 and 2030, we will miss the opportunity to get on track towards the ambitious target of about 1.5 degree temperature goal of the Paris Agreement. The report also mentions that as per the current commitments trends, the temperature will increase by 3.2 degrees over pre-industrial levels. The report also mentions that India is the third largest emitter after United States and China, and these positions are in terms of total amount of emissions released, but not on the basis of per capita emissions. If you include European Union into the list, then India's position is fourth largest emitter as per the report. If you see in terms of emissions per person or per capita, it is quite low in case of India, and we are not in the top 10 list. Now, let us see in brief about United Nations Environment Programme, which was established by a resolution in the Stockholm Conference on the Human Environment in 1972. The United Nations Environment Programme, that is UNEP, is the leading environmental authority in the United Nations system, and it uses its expertise to strengthen environmental standards and practices. And at the same time, it also helps in implementing the environmental obligations at various levels, that is at the country level, then at the regional levels, including global levels. Know that its headquarters is located at Nairobi in Kenya. So, with respect to this news article, we have seen about global warming, then greenhouse gases, then about UNFCCC, also about Kyoto Protocol and Paris Agreement under UNFCCC, and finally about the news article which discusses about the emissions gap report which is released by UNEP. Kindly notice that this topic is based on the upcoming Conference of Parties 25th, which is going to be held at Madrid, which is the capital city of Spain, and you will be seeing more news articles in the coming days regarding climate change, global warming, and also on COP25. Now, have a look at the practice question and will be discussed at the end of the session. Now, let us move on to the next news article. This editorial is based on the recent survey results of National Statistical Office. The survey is on drinking water, then sanitation, hygiene, and housing conditions. The objective of this survey was to examine and study different aspects of living conditions that are necessary for a decent and healthy living of the households. This survey also helps in developing suitable indicators based on the information that is collected. The syllabus relevant to this editorial is highlighted here for your reference. Now, the survey has assumed significance because the results of this survey have contradicted the claim of the government regarding the progress of Swachh Bharat program. On the occasion of Gandhi Jayanti this year, our Prime Minister proudly announced India as open defecation free, and he has mentioned that this was achieved as a result of the implementation of the Swachh Bharat program. But if you look at NSO survey findings, it shows that achieving ODF status is still in progress. So, in this context, we'll see why ODF is still in progress and how the findings of NSO survey are contradicting the statement of the Prime Minister. If you look at Swachh Bharat program, it has claimed that 95% of the rural households had toilet access, which means that only there is 5% deficit, that is, there are 5% of rural households which did not have toilet access. But the NSO survey showed that during the period from July to December in the year of 2018, when the survey was conducted, only about 71.3% of the households in the rural areas had toilet access. So if you compare the Swachh Bharat program results and NSO survey findings, this shows there is around 28% deficit. Then the survey results show that many states that were declared to be open defecation free has actually did not qualify for the status of ODF. And the survey has mentioned some of the states like Andhra Pradesh, then Gujarat, Maharashtra, Rajasthan, then Jharkhand, Karnataka, including Madhya Pradesh and Tamil Nadu. In these states, households neither had access to toilet nor they had toilet. In some other states, they have reported that the percentage in terms of lack of toilets is higher than the national average. And these states include the state of Jharkhand, then the state of Tamil Nadu and Rajasthan. So, author is suggesting that the NSO survey results can be used to review the performance of these states, which was initially reviewed by the Swachh Bharat program. Therefore, the central government should ideally treat the survey results as a fresh assessment of how much ground is to be covered. Then the survey is also important because it provides an opportunity to review other social determinants such as education, then housing and water supply. Because all these parameters have a strong influence on the adoption of sanitation. Here the author is noting that taking sanitation as a separate ideal will be pointless because the communities which are unable to see the benefits of sanitation due to overall deprivation of education, housing and water supply would be difficult for these households. But if you see the achievement announced by the Prime Minister of India, an ODF is just based on only one metric, that is the toilet access. We know that making India open defecation free is one of the objectives of the Swachh Bharat Mission program by construction of individual household toilets. Here, a duly completed household sanitary latrine shall comprise of three important components. Out of these three components, one is having a sanitary substructure. This substructure safely confines human feces and eliminates the need for human handling. Then the second component is a superstructure with a water facility. And final component is having a hand wash unit for cleaning and hand washing. Only if all the three components are there, we can say that a house has an individual household latrine. So under the Swachh Bharat program, there were allocation of funds and financial incentives for the vulnerable households to enable them to construct such toilets. So the government has included only this toilet access or construction as the measurement to declare open defecation free status. As per the government data, around 110 million or 11 crore toilets have been constructed since the launch of Swachh Bharat Mission in the October month of 2014. So we can say that the mere construction of toilet does not mean that people do not defecate openly. That is why the author is stating that this NSO survey is very important because the survey results add a new dimension for achieving ODF in addition to access to toilet. Now, as a result of the latest NSO survey, the government or the public now have access to another set of data, and this data will enable policymakers, including government, to act based on the new dimensions. Here the new dimensions which the author is talking is about rural housing and rural water supply. Therefore, these dimensions are key to bring toilet access to all. Furthermore, the NSO survey found that among the households that used latrine, about 4.5% of the households in the rural areas reported that water was not available in or around the latrine used. And with respect to rural housing, only about 76.7% of the households in the rural areas had the house of permanent structure, that is pakka structure. That is why the author is raising the questions that whether the Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana Gramin component will be able to bridge the existing gap, because under the scheme, government has the objective of housing for all by 2022. Therefore, to achieve the objective, about 2.95 crore new houses are said to be constructed by 2022. Now, one can say that the deficit in these two dimensions clearly show that there is a lack of development in the rural areas. And the author is stating that it will take a marathon program or long-lasting program to bring all-round development to India's villages, since the rural India have not really benefited from the economic growth of our country. It is also well recognized that development indices are low in some of the states. In addition to this, the local bodies lack the capacity and resources to bring universal sanitation, even though there is a political will. Therefore, to conclude this article, the author is demanding that a sustained work is required in the form of long-lasting program. And this sustained work should eliminate shortcomings in the ongoing programs, that is in terms of lack of housing and access to continuous water supply and such other socio-economic parameters. With this, we have come to the end of this news article analysis. The displayed practice question will be discussed at the end of the session. Now, let us start practice prelims question session. Now, look at this question. This question is that who releases emissions gap report? In the options they have given as Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, then International Energy Agency, then option C as United Nations Environment Program, then option D as International Solar Alliance. For this question, elimination of options is little bit difficult, but if you look at option D, that is International Solar Alliance, and this Solar Alliance is relatively new body, and as of now, there are no regular reports released by this body. Therefore, you can eliminate option D. Then look at option B, which says that International Energy Agency. And note that this International Energy Agency releases World Energy Outlook. Therefore, option B can be eliminated. Then option A says that it is a Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. And this IPCC, which prepares comprehensive assessment reports on climate change, and these reports are prepared by the working groups of IPCC. Know that scientists across the world form a part of this working group, and these scientists usually prepare comprehensive assessment reports on climate change on regular basis. Then option C says that it is a United Nations Environment Program. Kindly note that this UNEP releases emissions gap report. And recently it has released 10th emissions gap report, which has highlighted that the ongoing trend of releasing emissions gap into the atmosphere would breach the target of limiting the global warming by 2 degrees centigrade by the end of this century. The emissions gap report also mentions that the measures taken by the parties of the Paris Agreement are not sufficient to achieve the target of limiting the global rising temperature by 2 degrees centigrade by the end of this century. Therefore, for this question, option C, that is United Nations Environment Program, is the correct one. Now, look at this question. They have given three statements and you have to choose incorrect statements. The first statement says that the boundary of Union Territory of Dadra Nagar Haveli is located within the territory of Gujarat. And this statement is incorrect, because the boundary of Union Territory of Dadra Nagar Haveli shares border with two states, that is the state of Gujarat and the state of Maharashtra. Now, second statement says that in the union territory of Daman and Diu, Diu is located in the mainland of India and the Daman is an island located in Arabian Sea. This second statement is also incorrect because Diu is an island which is located in the Arabian Sea and Daman is located in the mainland, that is within the territory of the state of Gujarat. Now look at the third statement, which says that both the union territories, that is the union territory of Daman and Diu and the union territory of Dadra Nagar Haveli, are administered by the president. And this statement is correct because as per the article 239A clause 1, the union territories are administered by the president through an administrator appointed by the president. And the designation of such an administrator is specified by the president as per the article 239. Know that the administrator is known by different names in the different union territories, and in case of Andaman Nicobar Islands, and then in case of Delhi and Puducherry, and also in case of newly formed union territories of Jammu and Kashmir and Ladakh, these administrators are designated as lieutenant governors. The governor of Punjab is concurrently the administrator of Chandigarh. And in case of Dadra Nagar Haveli, the administrator of Dadra Nagar Haveli is concurrently the administrator of Daman and Diu. Here the designation is administrator. Also in the case of union territory of Lakshadweep, the designation is administrator of union territory of Lakshadweep. With respect to this question, you have to choose incorrect statements. Therefore, option A, that is 1 and 2, are incorrect statements. Now, look at this question. This question is with reference to Pradhan Mantri Mudra Yojana. And they have given three statements and you have to choose correct statements. Statement 1 says that the main objective of Pradhan Mantri Mudra Yojana is to fund the non-corporate, non-farming, small or micro enterprises. And this statement is correct statement because the main objective of this Mudra Yojana is to fund the non-corporate, non-farm, small or micro enterprises. Know that it was launched in 2015 under the Ministry of Finance. As per this Yojana, the beneficiaries mostly includes the non-corporate small business segment, which comprises like small manufacturing units, then the small service sector units, shopkeepers, then vegetable vendors, etc. Now look at the third statement. It says that the scheme comes under the Ministry of Micro, Small, Medium Enterprises. Kindly note that this scheme comes under the Ministry of Finance but not under the Ministry of MSME. So you can eliminate option C and you would be left with option A, that is 1 and 2 only. As additional information, the beneficiaries under this Pradhan Mantri Mudra Yojana can avail loans from commercial banks and also from regional rural banks, cooperative banks, including microfinance institutions and non-banking finance companies. Know that under this Mudra Yojana, there are three categories like Shishu category, then Kisho and then Tarun category. Shishu category covers loans up to 50,000 rupees, then above 50,000 rupees and up to 5 lakh rupees, the loans are given under Kishore category. Whereas in case of Tarun category, the loans covers above 5 lakh rupees but up to 10 lakh rupees. And these are the some of the details with respect to Pradhan Mantri Mudra Yojana. So for this question, option A, that is 1 and 2 only, is the correct option. Now have a look at this question, and this question is regarding Cartosat 3, and they have given three statements but you have to choose incorrect statements. Statement 1 says that it is an earth observation satellite. Then second statement says that Cartosat 3 can provide a resolution of 25 centimeters from the altitude of 500 kilometers. Then third statement says that under the remote sensing data policy of 2011, remote sensing data gathered by Cartosat 3 is accessible to private parties without prior permission.
know that CartoSat 3 satellite is the most advanced Earth observation satellite of ISRO, and it is a third generation advanced agile satellite which can move quickly and easily. That is the meaning of agile satellite. Its significant feature is that it will obtain panchromatic and multispectral imagery. Therefore, first statement is correct. So you can eliminate options A and D because statement 1 is correct. Know that CartoSat 3 offers the best ever resolution of about 25 centimeters in the entire CartoSat series of ISRO. It means that from a height of around 500 kilometers, the satellite can pick up an object with a minimum size of 25 centimeters. And the previous best of the CartoSat series was about 65 centimeters. Therefore, second statement is also correct statement. Now look at the third statement, which says that under the remote sensing data policy of 2011, remote sensing data that is gathered by CartoSat 3 is accessible to private parties without prior permission. See, as per the remote sensing data policy of 2011, which was adapted by the Government of India, prescribes the following guidelines to be adapted. That is, first one is that all data of resolution up to 1 meter shall be distributed on a non-discriminative basis, but on as a requested basis. Then the next rule says that with a view to protect national security interest, all data of better than 1 meter resolution shall be screened and cleared by the appropriate agency prior to the distribution. Therefore, the given third statement is incorrect statement. For this question, they are asking that you have to choose incorrect statement. So option B, that is statement 3, is the correct option for this question. Now look at this question, which is a practice mains question, which says that the recent NSO survey findings show that achieving ODF is still in progress, and in the light of the above statement, discuss the findings and the importance of the NSO survey. As we have mentioned that it is a part of our practice mains question series, and you can post your written answer in the comment section of the video, which will be evaluated and appropriate feedback will be given to the aspirants. With this, we have come to the end of the analysis of today's session. If you like the video, kindly do like, comment, share and subscribe the Shankar IAS Academy channel for daily updates. Thank you.